and the anger in her face turned to surprise or wonder or fear or something, and she slowly brought out her hands from her pockets and opened them and held them so. In one was my piece of money, in the other lay 4 silver groschen. She gazed a little while, perhaps to see if the groschen would vanish away. Then she said fervently, "It's true, it's true, and I'm ashamed and beg forgiveness, O dear master and benefactor." And she ran to Satan and kissed his hand over and over again, according to the Austrian custom. In her heart she probably believed it was a witch-cat and an agent of the devil. But no matter, it was all the more certain to be able to keep its contract and furnish a daily good living for the family, for in matters of finance even the piousest of our peasants would have more confidence in an arrangement with the devil than with an archangel. Ursula started homeward with Agnes in her arms, and I said I wished I had her privilege of seeing Margaret. Then I caught my breath, for we were there. There in the parlor, and Margaret standing looking at us, astonished. She was feeble and pale, but I knew that those conditions would not last in Satan's atmosphere, and it turned out so. I introduced Satan, that is, Philip Traum, and we sat down and talked. There was no constraint. We were simple folk in our village, and when a stranger was a pleasant person, we were soon friends. Margaret wondered how we got in without her hearing us. Traum said the door was open, and we walked in and waited until she should turn around and greet us. This was not true. No door was open. We entered through the walls or the roof or down the chimney, or somehow. But no matter. What Satan wished a person to believe, the person was sure to believe. And so Margaret was quite satisfied.